Greetings to all, and welcome to this session on career opportunities in the Indian Forest Service. Today we will have a look at the brief background of this service, its evolution since its inception, the recruitment process, and what this job entails on a day-to-day basis. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Himne, Dr. Setia, and the entire team of CRANES for inviting me to the platform of Botany for You. As I understand, friends, you are all at a critical juncture in your careers where you might be choosing the options for going for a higher education, or you might be looking at opportunities that are available in your in the different fields, particularly in the life sciences. And this is one great opportunity that any person with a degree in the life sciences can look at. And I sincerely thank Dr. Himne and their team for this noble endeavor where they are trying to guide young minds towards their desired goals. So I will start with a brief introduction about myself. I am Siddesh Savadekar. I am an Indian Forest Service officer of the 2015 batch. Presently, I am serving as a Deputy Conservator of Forest of Bhamragad Division in the district of Gadchiroli, Maharashtra. By education, I am an electrical engineer. I have completed my graduation from VGTI Mumbai in the year 2010, and I am a native of Thane district.
Let us now begin with our presentation. Before I talk about the Indian Forest Service, I would like to talk about the civil services in general and the role they have to play in our democratic structure. Now, as we all know, we inherited this structure from the British administration, and consequent to our needs or changing demands, we have adapted this organization to suit the present times. So, an organization which used to focus on revenue generation during that period is now more focused on the welfare of its people, its developmental needs, and as such, it affects all the services. So see that the Indian Forest Service has also evolved from what it was in the British times to what it is now in the present. And to talk about the role of the different services, we have a parliamentary system wherein we have periodic elections and new governments come to power, new policies are drafted and implemented. And as such, there is a semblance of instability that is visible. And under this visible chaos, to provide the stability that is required for progress, for attending to the needs of the people, is provided by this permanent structure called as the civil service. And as such, it has rightly been called as the steel frame of India. So we now understand what a crucial role this civil services plays in our democratic polity. Now, this is a very crucial question one has to face when one decides to take up the path of civil services. Why indeed would anyone want to get into this service? Is it because you want to serve the nation? Is it because of the prestige and status associated with the job? Is it because of the job profile or the pay or the job security that a government job entails? Or is it the diversity of work? Choosing the right option and having the right reasons to be associated or to try to get into the service is very, very important. Public service needs motivation, needs commitment to the cause and a spirit of service. The times we live in today are demand driven. People are more aware of their rights, people are more aware of their needs, and as such, public service cannot lag behind. And there is a continuous scrutiny of the performance of the government, of the performance of the services, and there is no scope for failure also. So as such, it is a very, very challenging job in today's changed times. Having looked at the crucial role the civil services play in our democratic polity, we now take a look at the Indian Forest Service and its background. So Indian Forest Service is an all India service, one amongst the three, along with the Indian Administrative Service and the Indian Police Service. It has been established by an Act of Parliament in 1966. Forests is a concurrent subject in the concurrent list, And as such, we have a state forest department as well as a central ministry also to deal with this subject. As of now, there are around 3,000 officers in this service, serving in different parts of the country in different capacities. The legacy of this service dates back to 1860s, when the British established the forest department in India for the first time. And Dietrich Brandes is rightly known as the father of Indian forestry, and it is he who brought about scientific forestry to the tropical countries and particularly to India, and the management of our forest resources based on the newly developed science was started. So it has a long legacy, and its evolution from the Imperial Forest Service to the present Indian Forest Service is quite interesting. So when we talk about evolution, we look at the role of the Forest Department in British India and its role in the present. So when the British established the Forest Department, they looked at it purely from the point of view of production, that the vast resources available in India's forests were to be harvested and put to the needs and uses of the industrial economy of England. And there was very little scope for protection, very little scope for conservation, and whatever resources were available were supposed to be augmented for the developmental needs. So it was basically an extractive mode of utilization, and which definitely led to a destruction of a number of resources. And at the same time, wildlife was only looked at from the point of view of game or hunting, and as a sport itself. There was no emphasis on biodiversity conservation. Definitely there was an emphasis on understanding the various species of plants or maybe animals, or the different resources that are available, and there was a race to name and identify them. Regarding biodiversity conservation, we can definitely credit the British with the identification of the various flora and fauna found in the subcontinent, and giving a scientific basis to their classification, as well as understanding the nature of diversity within this part of the world. Regarding livelihood issues, it was a lesser concern. The major concern being the needs of the British administration and the needs of England. So everything that was available was firstly reserved for the government, and whatever was surplus was then made available to the natives. And so when India became independent, our needs and requirements were naturally different from those of the erstwhile colonial power. What we focused on was protection. We focused on the conservation aspect of forestry. We realized that hunting and poaching would lead to the extinction of the fauna that India used to have in abundant numbers, and therefore laws to protect wildlife and to manage them in their habitats were brought in. Also the aspect of biodiversity conservation was realized. So India is a hugely biodiverse country, and unless and until efforts are made to conserve that biodiversity, the world itself faces a huge loss. Also we changed our system of management from top to bottom to be more participatory. Now we have schemes like the Joint Forest Management, which is basically community participation into the management of the local resources. Unless and until people feel ownership about the resources that are available near them, there cannot be better management. Once the community is involved in the protection and the management of the resources, it leads to better results, and it naturally leads to better protection and improvement in those resources. They feel a sense of ownership, and also it leads to a greater democratic way of life. So this was all about the evolution of the service or the department. Now we'll have a look at the recruitment process that is followed for the Indian Forest Service. So the recruitment is conducted by the Union Public Service Commission through a national level exam. The selection is based on merit and it is conducted every year. As recently as 2012, the recruitment used to be conducted through a direct exam and an interview after that. But having been made a part of the civil services examination procedure, now candidates have to appear for the civil services preliminary examination and then the Indian Forest Service mains examination and then the interview to get through into the service. As depicted in the PPT, you can go at the link on the website of UPSC and have a look at the notification for the current year's exam. This notification has all the details such as the eligibility criteria, educational requirements, the medical requirements, and as well as the different optional subjects, the syllabus required for the exam, and the scheme of examination and structure of the examination. Briefly, the scheme of the examination consists of two stages. The stage one is the preliminary stage, which is common to the civil services as well as the Indian Forest Service. And it consists of two papers of 200 marks each. The first paper of which is considered for selection on screening. And the second paper is qualifying only. So there is a negative marking and it is an objective type of exam paper, which most of us are nowadays familiar with. Stage 2 is written and the interview stage, wherein the written exam is an essay type of exam. It consists of 6 papers of 1400 marks and the interview stage is of 300 marks. So of these 6 papers, there are 2 papers on general English and general knowledge, and the remaining 4 papers are 2 optionals each. So we have to choose certain optionals. There are a list of 14 subjects that can be chosen. It is crucial to note that the educational qualifications specify the minimum requirement of a degree in one of the life sciences or mathematics, or in one of agriculture, forestry or engineering from any of recognized universities in India. So this basic requirement means that the students from the field of the life sciences have a natural edge in this competition for this examination. Also, the optional subjects, if you go through them, there are 14 of them, and having a background or a graduation or a post-graduation in one of these subjects definitely gives you an advantage when you're competing with the person who is from an engineering background and needs to study forestry or geology as an optional subject. Well, so once the recruitment is completed, the candidates are required to go through a training program that is very carefully curated. It consists of a foundation course that is conducted at the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration in Mussoorie. Then the professional phase of the training, which is conducted at the respective professional academies. And then an on-the-job training, which involves an attachment in the respective states and in a district, and to learn the various aspects on a day-to-day basis. So the training for the Indian Forest Service, the foundation course, is conducted at Labasna. The professional training is conducted at the Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy. It is located in the FRI campus, the Forest Research Institute campus in Dehradun, and is the premier institute for the training of the Indian Forest Service officers. So on-the-job training is conducted once the 16-20 months of FC foundation course and the professional phase are completed, and the candidates or the officers are sent to their respective states. Since the Indian Forest Service has a cadre-based system, each officer who is allocated to a particular cadre is sent to that cadre, and there in the district or there in the state government allots them the posting wherein they wherein they undergo the on-the-job training. As regards the training aspect, I would definitely say that Indian Forest Service has one of the best trainings, and it is a mix of both academics as well as practical or study tools to understand the nature of working of the forest department in different parts of the country. India has a huge diversity of forests at its hand, and its management has different approaches. What we see in the Himalayan states completely differs to what we see in the coastal states. What we see in the northeast completely differs to what we see in the desert or the barren areas of Rajasthan and Gujarat. So, understanding those management initiatives or perspectives is very important to the development of an officer. Now, this is just a glimpse of the hierarchy that is present in the state forest department. So, when a newly recruited for Indian Forest Service officer after training joins the state, he is generally posted in a training capacity as an assistant conservator of forest. So, the first actual posting that an IFS officer is given is that of a deputy conservator of forest. Next is the conservator of forest, the chief conservator, the additional principal chief conservator, and the highest post that any forest department or the state forest department has is the principal chief conservator of forest. So till now we have looked at the background, we have looked at the recruitment process, the evolution of the service and the basic aspects about training. I have not gone into the details of the training. It is actually a very wonderful experience. But considering the paucity of time, I just introduced it to you. Mainly I want to talk about what this job entails on a day-to-day basis, what we do when we are actually posted as a deputy conservator of forest or a chief conservator of forest or a chief conservator of forest, or in many terms they use an alternate term, that is a district forest officer or a divisional forest officer, DFO. You might be more familiar with the term DFO. So herein comes the appeal that any student of life sciences might have towards the forest department or the Indian Forest Service in particular. Having a background in a subject such as botany or zoology or a veterinarian can be a very, very crucial advantage when one is serving as an officer in the field. Consider a case wherein there is a wild animal that has been injured, or there is an issue with a carnivore which has been attacking cattle, and there your knowledge, specialized knowledge of a veterinarian can be very handy. Consider a similar issue wherein you are working in an area which is richly biodiverse, and your knowledge of plants, your background of botany can help you in identifying a species or a subspecies and understanding the conservation value and the richness of its potential. So this can be a very, very crucial thing and can give you the edge among your peers. But at the same time, one must bear in mind that we have been appointed as managers. Our job is to manage these resources in a better way, so as to conserve them, so as to ensure their sustainable use and benefits to the local population. On this slide, I have listed only a few of the objectives for the forest department. Beyond these, there are many beyond these, but these I feel are the most crucial. So our first and foremost focus is the protection and the conservation of our resource. We also take up activities that come under the aspect of management. We have a crucial role to play in biodiversity conservation. Wildlife management again is a very, very crucial thing. And at the same time, participation of the community, involving the local community in the management of the resources. So regarding protection and conservation, the most crucial task handed to the forest department is the enforcement of the various state and central laws. The Indian Forest Act of 1927 and its state amendments is the most crucial law that protects our forests. At the same time, Wildlife Protection Law of 1972 is another which has changed the scene of wildlife management in India. Forest Conservation Act was enacted in 1980. In the face of large-scale de-reservation of forests and to limit the non-forestry use of our forest areas. Other than this, the Forest Rights Act of 2006 has been a game changer in the management of our forests, and it has empowered the local communities to have better control, better management of the local resources while recognizing their traditional rights for the individual as well as the community. Also, it has given a new perspective wherein the government is not the sole authority or not the only rights holder for a particular resource, and the community is an equal stakeholder. So the implementation and enforcement of these laws is the crucial task that the department has to perform, and there are various challenges that we face. There are various problems that arise. There is a problem of illicit cutting, there is a problem of encroachment, there is a problem of illicit transport of resources within the forest areas to outside. All these are kept in check by through the enforcement of these laws. Coming to the point of forest management, we talk about the scientific management of forests since the British times. And for this purpose, the department has developed working plans for specific areas, management plans for the wildlife areas, and these plans are basically management inputs along the lines of the concepts developed in forestry and how to manage these areas for a sustainable use. And a necessary corollary of scientific management is one might take up afforestation activities to improve degraded areas, to bring up more areas under a better forest cover, to have a greater biodiversity, to reintroduce species that have become rare, or to conserve them. This is wherein the technical expertise of the forest department comes in, and wherein we try to manage the forests on scientific lines. These are the photographs of a timber depot wherein after the implementation of the working plan, the resources that have been extracted, the trees that have been extracted, are brought for auction and sold in online auctions. This is one of the afforestation activities undertaken in one of the degraded areas, and we are trying to regenerate this area using the local species such as tendu, moha, and bamboo. So, wildlife management has become one of the crucial areas wherein the forest department is required to step in. There are increasing instances of human-wildlife interaction, and with negative consequences for either the human or the animal or both. And in such cases, we are required to manage their habitat better. So, this here is another photograph wherein we were required to transport bear cubs to a zoo, and we had to make arrangements for the safe translocation, and you can see the effort that people are putting in. So I have tried to give you a glimpse about what this service is about and what this job entails on a day-to-day basis. I hope I have done justice to the cause. So, coming to the part of challenges, the most important challenge that the department faces today is balancing the aspect of environmental protection against that of the developmental needs. So, we are progressing as a country, and consequently there is a huge clamor for developmental activities, be it roads, be it electric lines, be it dams. And another crucial challenge that we face is that of climate change and how it will affect our vast forest resources. So this is where we have to understand that climate change is going to be a certainty in the times to come, and we have to adapt ourselves and our resources to the changing conditions. Therefore, we have to be ready with mitigation and adaptive measures so that the fallout is minimal. Next aspect is the sustainable management of our resources. Now, India has huge potential and huge resources at its disposal, but uninhibited use of these resources can only be harmful for us. Therefore, the most important thing that we face right now is how do we manage this sustainably? What paradigms do we develop for development, that only that much is extracted or that much is used which is required for now, and the further coming generations will have enough left for them. Another challenge can be said to be the corollary of the first challenge, but I specifically mentioned it differently because we are looking at unprecedented urbanization of India at this point of time, and we are looking at development, we are progressing as a country, wherein there is a huge pressure on our natural resources. So conserving the wild for the wild animals is going to be a challenge for all of us, and the forest department will have to take it head on. We'll have to deal with the problems of habitat fragmentation, we'll have to deal with the problems of human-wildlife interaction, and that is why I needed to give you this perspective that this is going to be a challenge in the times to come. So I have tried to talk about the various aspects as well as the challenges that this service can offer, and anyone who would like a diverse job, anyone who would like to be moving around in the field and not just sitting at a desk, is definitely should think about trying for this service or getting into this service. Another thing is about interest. Anyone who is interested in nature, anyone who is interested in the outdoors, in wildlife, should definitely try for this service. It is a very, very wonderful service. Anyone with a background from the life sciences who is interested in this field should definitely think about the service, not just for furthering his own knowledge, but as a contribution to society, as a contribution to our people that their expertise can give. So I would only say this, that we generally speak in the service that we are paid to do a job for which people are willing to pay. People are willing to pay to go near to nature, and we are paid for it. So that is one thing to bear in mind while preparing for this service. So I end with this thought that if you can dream it, then you can make it so. Thank you once again, Dr. Humne, Dr. Setia, and the team of Cranes for giving me this opportunity and to reaching out to an audience who is at a crucial juncture in their careers. So I hope I am able to make a small contribution towards it. Thank you.